Armed Forces. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my distinct pleasure to introduce our leader, our Secretary of Defense, Donald Rumsfeld.
Pete Aldrich, Service Secretaries, distinguished officials of the Department of Defense, General Myers, thank you very much for those kind words. The topic today is an adversary that poses a threat, serious threat to security of the United States of America. This adversary is one of the world's last bastions of central planning, governs by dictating five-year plans from a single capital that attempts to impose its command across time zones, continents, oceans, and beyond. With brutal consistency, it stifles free thought, crushes new ideas. It disrupts the defense of the United States and places the lives of men and women in uniform at risk. Perhaps this adversary sounds like the former Soviet Union, but that enemy's gone. Our foes are more subtle and implacable today. You may think I'm describing one of the last decrepit dictators of the world, but their day too is almost past, and they cannot match the strength or size. The adversary is closer to home. It's the Pentagon bureaucracy. Not the people, but the processes. Not the civilians, but the systems. Not the men and women in uniform, but the uniformity of thought and action that we too often impose on them. In this building, despite the era of scarce resources, taxed by mounting threats, money disappears into duplicative duties, bloated bureaucracy, not because of greed, but gridlock. Innovation is stifled not by ill intent, but by institutional inertia. Just as we must transform America's military capability to meet changing threats, we must transform the way the department works and what it works on. We must build a department where each of the dedicated people here can apply their immense talents to defend America, where they have the resources, information, and freedom to perform. Our challenge is to transform not just the way we deter and defend, but the way we conduct our daily business. Let's make no mistake, the modernization of the Department of Defense is a matter of some urgency. In fact, it could be said that it's a matter of life and death, ultimately, every American. A new idea ignored may be the next threat overlooked. A person employed in a redundant task is one who could be countering terrorism or nuclear proliferation. Every dollar squandered on waste is one denied to the warfighter. That's why we're here today, challenging us all to wage an all-out campaign to shift Pentagon's resources from bureaucracy to the battlefield, from tail to the tooth. We know the adversary, we know the threat, and with the same firmness of purpose that any effort against a determined adversary demands, we must get at it and stay at it. Some might ask, how in the world could the Secretary of Defense attack the Pentagon in front of its people? To them I reply, I have no desire to attack the Pentagon. I want to liberate it. We need to save it from itself. The men and women of this department, civilians and militaries, are our allies, not our enemies. They too are fed up with bureaucracy. They too live with frustrations. I hear it every day. And I'll bet a dollar to a dime that they too want to fix it. In fact, I bet they even know how to fix it. And if asked, we'll get about the task of fixing it. And I'm asking. They know that the taxpayers deserve better. Every dollar we spend was entrusted to us by a taxpayer who earned it by creating something of value with sweat and skill. A cashier in Chicago, a waitress in San Francisco. An average American family works an entire year to generate $6,000 in income taxes. Here we spill many times that amount every hour by duplication and by inattention. That's wrong. It's wrong because national defense depends on public trust, and trust in turn hinges on respect for the hardworking people of America and the tax dollars they earn. We need to respect them and their efforts. waste drains resources from training and tanks, from infrastructure and intelligence, from helicopters and housing. Outdated systems crush ideas that could save a life. Redundant processes prevent us from adapting to evolving threats with the speed and agility that today's world demands. Above all, the shift from bureaucracy to the battlefield is a matter of national security. In this period of limited funds, we need every nickel, every good idea, every innovation, every effort to help modernize and transform the U.S. military. We must change for a simple reason. The world has, and we have not yet changed sufficiently. The clearest and most important transformation is from a bipolar Cold War world where threats were visible and predictable to one in which they arise from multiple sources, most of which are difficult to anticipate, and many of which are impossible even to know today. Let there be no question. The 2.7 million people who wear our country's uniform, active, guard, and reserve, and the close to 700,000 more who support them in civilian attire, comprise the finest military in the history of the world. They stand ready to face down any threat, anytime, anywhere. But we must do more. We must develop and build weapons to deter those new threats. We must rebuild our infrastructure, which is in a very serious state of disrepair. And we must assure that the noble cause of military service remains the high calling that will attract the very best. All this costs money. It costs more than we have. It demands agility, more than today's bureaucracy allows. And that means we must recognize another transformation, the revolution in management, technology, and business practices. Successful modern businesses are leaner and less hierarchical than ever before. They reward innovation and they share information. They have to be nimble in the face of rapid change or they die. Business enterprises die if they fail to adapt. And the fact that they can fail and die is what provides the incentive to survive. But governments can't die. So we need to find other incentives for bureaucracy to adapt and improve. The technology revolution has transformed organizations across the private sector, but not ours, not fully, not yet. We are, as they say, tangled in our anchor chain. Our financial systems are decades old. According to some estimates, we cannot track $2.3 trillion in transactions. We cannot share information from floor to floor in this building because it's stored on dozens of different technological systems that are inaccessible or incompatible. We maintain 20 to 25% more base infrastructure than we need to support our forces at an annual waste to taxpayers of some $3 to $4 billion. Fully half of our resources go to infrastructure and overhead, and in addition to draining resources from warfighting, these costly and outdated systems, procedures, and programs stifle innovation as well. A new idea must often survive the gauntlet of some 17 levels of bureaucracy to make it from a line officer's head to my desk. I have too much respect for a line officer to believe that we need 17 layers between us. Our business process and regulation seems to be engineered to prevent any mistake, and by so doing, they discourage any risk. But ours is a nation born of ideas and raised on improbability. And risk aversion is not America's ethic. And more important, it must not be ours. Those who fear danger do not volunteer to storm beaches and take hills, sail the seas, and conquer the skies. Now we must free you to take some of the same thoughtful, reasoned risks in the bureaucracy that the men and women in uniform do in battle. To that end, we're announcing today a series of steps the Department of Defense will take to shift our focus and our resources from bureaucracy to battlefield, from tail to tooth. Today's announcements are only the first of many. We will launch others ourselves, and we will ask Congress for legislative help as well. We have, for example, asked Congress for permission to begin the process of closing excess bases and consolidating the B-1 bomber force. But we have the ability and therefore the responsibility to reduce waste and improve operational efficiency on our own. Already, we've made some progress. We've eliminated some 31 of the 72 acquisition-related advisory boards. We now budget based on realistic estimates. We're improving the acquisition process. We're investing $400 million in public-private partnerships for military housing. Many utility services to military installations will be privatized. We're tightening the requirements for other government agencies to reimburse us for detailees. And we're reviewing to see whether we should suspend assignments where detailees are not fully reimbursed. We have committed $100 million for financial modernization, and we're establishing a defense business board to tap outside expertise as we move to improve the department's business practices. We can be proud of this progress, but certainly not satisfied. To succeed, this effort demands personal and sustained attention at the highest levels of the department. Therefore, it will be guided by the Senior Executive Council, including Undersecretary Pete Aldrich, Army Secretary Thomas White, Navy Secretary Gordon England, and Air Force Secretary Jim Roach. These leaders are experienced, talented, and determined. I am delighted they are on our team. I would not want to try to stop them from what they came into this department to do. I expect them to be enormously successful, as they have in their